All right, welcome back to the weekly game. It's your host, AB. We got Drew and Turk here. I believe you can see our Twitter handles below. As always, subscribe.
Above, below.
As above, so below.
Anywhere you look. You know, what's really interesting is we can put it anywhere we want.
Anywhere on the screen. Anywhere. It doesn't matter. You'd see it everywhere.
Well, to be fair, my head is huge. It's going to probably have to go
below. Right on your head.
Yeah.
You'll just be wearing it. Just be wearing the handle.
I think we could actually do that.
Yeah.
I think we should try it.
Eyebrows.
The app.
At Turkleton.
You know what? Speaking of eyebrows, let's talk about the Super Bowl. So Super Bowl Sunday came and went. Mostly, I think it fizzled and faded, if you will, generally speaking. Anybody have any strong takes that haven't already been made?
Haven't already been made, huh?
Oh, yeah.
There's no original thoughts on planet Earth that hasn't been. For the last 87 years and 2 months. So I really got
specifically
nothing. Tom Brady,
Super Bowl.
I refuse to watch these episodes, by the way, that we record. So I can only go off what people tell me happened on the previous episode. And apparently I called Tom Brady a shit cunt. And post Super Bowl, I still firmly believe that Tom Brady's a shit cunt.
So when he said
a unique take that no one else.
Everyone counted us out.
I like that.
And when he said that, I was like, "Well, fuck, you know, like who's everyone? It's like zero people counted you out. You know, like, who counted you out? This is the asshole that counted you out." Actually,
I didn't count him out. I think he's a shit cunt.
Just a shit cunt.
Yeah, that's different.
Great. He's a great baller. Shit cunt.
Well, he's a cheater and a shit cunt, and he is decent as a quarterback, as a Hall of Fame quarterback.
And he's a blame it on the ball boy kind of guy, you know.
He's definitely a Lance Armstrong kind of
Who did Lance Armstrong blame?
He's definitely a Derrick.
Oh, you don't know about that?
No.
Lance Armstrong ruined people's lives who came out and said that he had been cheating and they'd been helping him, dragged their names through the mud, sued them, ruined their lives, and then later had to come out and say, "Oh, by the way, I was doing all those things that those people said whose lives that I ruined." Very specifically, Lance Armstrong is the benchmark for shit cuntedness.
You know,
and Tom Brady is following in those footsteps.
You know, they say time heals all wounds, right? I completely forgot about that Lance Armstrong stuff, but you're right.
He destroyed.
I forgot.
People's lives who
I forgot
broke
steroids.
People who undermine. Look, if it's your life's work to work with cyclists and be a cyclist trainer, and you've dedicated your whole life to that, and then you reach the pinnacle of that working with Lance Armstrong, and then he goads you and talks you into going against the code that you've always lived by, and then turns around and destroys you for doing his evil bidding. Does it get worse than that? I know we're going on a tangent here, but that's how I feel about Tom Brady and the people that whose lives he has ruined in order to maintain his good standing.
So, what do you feel about Barry Bonds?
These are just my opinions.
They weren't that. I mean,
these are just my opinions.
No, I get it. Totally.
He was a ball boy. Saying ball boys have feelings, Drew.
One guy was doing fecal transplants. The other guy was letting little air out.
The other guy was a ball boy who is no longer a ball boy.
No, he's not.
He lost his job. He's lost his good name.
A ball boy.
Whether he was a ball boy.
Do we know his name by chance?
Hey,
just off the top of our heads.
If a waiter drops,
not to look it up because
Google will tell you.
No, absolutely.
If a waiter drops a bag of cocaine in the dish room and then blames the dishwasher and the dishwasher loses his job as a result of that, that guy's life is ruined even though he's just a dishwasher.
Does he keep the bag?
The manager keeps the bag. He does
naturally.
After he fires the waiter.
You're fired.
Right. Anyways,
you're working a double tomorrow.
Was the dishwasher Colombian?
Yeah, so you can see how this got off.
But the dishwasher was white, Aaron. I don't know why you assume.
Who's coming?
What kind of fancy upscale restaurant is this?
Exactly.
I think we need to stop where we're going right now and then
reverse. Take a step back. They're like,
and
well,
then back to football.
It was a much better show last week. But they're telling us,
I've worked in a restaurant. Don't delude yourself.
Yeah, exactly.
You worked in a restaurant in Texas.
No,
not all dish rooms are created equal, my friend.
I worked in a restaurant in Maryland, and yeah, they're the exact same as they are in Texas.
I worked in restaurants for decades, and I've seen.
Man.
I've seen dishwashers of all sexes, colors, and nationalities. All right?
Fair enough.
Moving on, though, and we're sorry.
They usually come in, like, stainless steel.
If there's any...
Black,
yeah, in case Columbia Sports wants to sponsor a mediocre to subpar podcast...
And we're running out. We're running low.
We don't believe that all dishwashers are Colombian.
Fair enough.
So, yeah, the Super Bowl ended not to my liking.
But not to many people's liking.
It was how I thought it was going to be. The Patriots came out on top. That part doesn't surprise me. What also doesn't surprise me is that a late mistake Belichick's team capitalized on. Right? That's what they do. They keep it close. They strike. You can't be perfect for a whole game, and they can.
I'm going to find us the stat, but there is a stat on Belichick when he faces quarterbacks 25 years of age or younger.
Does basically destroy him?
Undefeated.
He eats them for lunch.
So this is something that was just like under the radar. No one was really thinking about it.
Do you think young quarterbacks
know.
Like see them in his night, see him in their nightmares?
Yeah, I think based on the way that McVay conducted himself leading up to and during the Super Bowl, I think he sees Belichick in his fantasies more than his nightmares.
Well,
yeah.
I don't know if we
he was sucking the teat. Bill Belichick the whole week.
Multiple games this year, after the Rams played, he would get a call, McVay would get a call from Belichick congratulating him.
They've been texting and talking all year,
all
and
season.
Maybe that was the long con by Belichick.
Yeah, exactly. Like, hey, I'll see you soon, bud. What's your running over there?
Hey, if anybody knows to keep your friends close and your enemies closer, it's going to be Bill Belichick. So I wouldn't put it past him
I remember
recognized that he may, in fact, be facing off with the next best football mind in the game.
I think there's a lot of psychological warfare in football, right? I think the insignias do matter, the lore, where you play, your fan base. I think a lot of that stuff matters. When I think about Belichick and his ability to play head games with other coaches, I think about how he did Mangini. I mean, he just haunted that poor guy and made him ridiculous, and he ended up being ridiculous.
And for those of you that were not privy to what Aaron's talking about, you're going to see it again and again with the new Belichick disciples. There's one in Houston, there's one in Detroit, there's about to be one in Miami, and all of them will be exploited by their Lord and Savior.
Yes,
will be.
I've seen
the Texans face the Patriots countless times, and it's the same result.
He exploits Billy every time he plays him. I mean, and it's funny the way they talk about O'Brien when they're playing him. I mean, it's psychological warfare at the highest level, and they're masters of it. And so I think that's a phase of the game that they're going to win almost every single time. And
you know what's interesting? I don't think Belichick minds that these guys leave and go elsewhere because then he gets to face them and
he knows their tendencies.
Father them. But
and
it is also interesting.
They think they know his.
It is. They do think that. They think they can be like him.
Mm-hmm. I think Vrabel's done a decent job.
Well, you know what I think is interesting as well as we're talking about this and the countless coaches from the Belichick tree that have been owned by him post-Patriots, is that there's only one that he ever brought back into the hen house. Mm-hmm. And it's the one that I said last week as important to that team as the other two that everyone wants to talk about. It's McDaniels.
Well, and you look at what the Patriots said coming out of this game was it was him at halftime that sparked them, and he's the reason that they came out and were able to do what they did in the second half.
Yeah, I heard something that I really didn't pick up on watching the game. That maybe at halftime, but I think it was even a little later than that, McDaniels pulled everybody together and he said, we're going to do something that we haven't done for years. We're going to huddle on every play. And I'm not sure how that affected the way that...
The tempo.
I can tell you that the first drive that they did that on was the drive that Gronkowski caught that long pass near the goal line, and then they scored. So go back and watch that game. I believe, and again, this is secondhand, I heard someone talking about this, that beginning with that drive that they started huddling on every down, which is something they never do.
Had something to do with by doing that, extending the play clock, running it down, shortening the game, right?
Keep it out of the LSA.
Which is insane to do when it's tied 3-3 in the last game of the year. But yes, that had something to do with it.
But man, again, right? I said it going into the game. Belichick in a close game, you make the mistake, he capitalizes.
Right.
That's what happened. The end result was what it was. And yeah, Gronk was the outlet. Dude, the play to knock the ball out of Brandon Cook's hand in the end zone was maybe the best defensive play I've seen in a really long time. And I believe that was more important than the interception, because the interception was on a drive, and yeah, they would have been close. Maybe they scored if he caught the ball, maybe they didn't. But that play, Brandon Cooks was in the end zone with the ball in his hands, and Devin McCourty knocked it out of his hand. Ridiculous.
Yeah.
Now, he wouldn't have been able to do that to D-Hop, man. Woo! Them hands.
And again, like we're not going to get into it yet, but just keep in mind, you guys are going to have Demaryius Thomas back next year, and that offense is completely different.
We should.
Yeah, I don't think he's under contract.
He's coming back from an Achilles, right?
And because of that, I think in the second half of next year, I think you'll retain him. Anyways, I do want to talk about how ineffective Jared Goff was.
So real quick, before we get into Goff, let's hit our predictions of our bets that we talked about last week. There wasn't very many of them. We didn't do that great. Like we said, the money line hit, right? The Patriots won. Tails never fails, right? The coin toss was once again tails.
Right.
And I believe, like, over the last 9 years, once it's been heads, I mean, tails really never fails. The over-under on James White catches, that was a big miss, right? He was absent from the game.
Right? Multiple wagers on James White. I had James White scoring the first touchdown of the game. James White scoring the first Patriots touchdown of the game. James White over 58 yards. I had James White over 6 catches. Like,
brutal.
Miss. It was not lost on me that 2 times James White caught the ball and then flags were almost immediately thrown.
Right.
You know, the conspiracy theory in me, theorist in me, wants to believe that a lot of people, I mean, there were billions of dollars wagered on this game. I'm guessing there was a bunch of money
on James White.
And the second flag I found particularly interesting, because it was a catch that would have at the time been his second or third had the first flag not been thrown. And that it was a penalty in favor of the Patriots, so they moved the chains. But importantly, he didn't get that reception, right? Yeah. And that was early in the third quarter that second flag was thrown. So, again, my conspiracy theory mind is thinking that there was a ton of money on James White prop bets, like a lot, because I went straight for that. I mean, I'm looking through hundreds of options, and I isolated James White, and I tend to believe that a lot of people did as well.
Yeah, given his last 2 Super Bowl performances. Mm-hmm. It was in a very attractive line of thinking, right?
So those 2 flags felt pretty coincidental to me, but I put my money where my mouth was on James White.
They painted with those wagers out there.
I put my money where my mouth was, and I got hammered on James White. So James White,
so last
I'm done
one,
with you.
Over-under Todd Gurley on yards. You know, not only did he miss it, he was an actual dud in the game and in the playoffs overall. And people are talking crazy about that's why you shouldn't pay a running back $50 million.
That's all it takes is one team to pay a guy. So I don't know that that's going to – I've heard the talk. Sidebar really quick. You brought up the bad beat of the year.
Oh, yeah. Did you?
Well, yeah, what was it?
So it was – let's see. Let's see if we –
check this out.
So there was a radio host up in, I guess, the Pittsburgh or New England area, maybe.
KC The Brick, right?
No, it wasn't The Brick. It was more of a local host, which is a syndicated show.
I recognize
show.
His name, Jason Smith or something like that.
So it was a prop on...
So I listen to late John Smith?
It was, no, was it? Less receiving yards, Chris Hogan or
Todd Gurley.
And so Hogan had 5 targets, 0 receptions for 0 yards. Gurley had a reception for -1 yards.
So he bet Gurley.
He bet on Gurley and got cracked.
And the odds were obviously in Gurley's favor.
Oh, absolutely. So yeah, that's a...
He bet on Gurley. Gurley had -1 and Hogan had 0.
-1 receiving yards in the Super Bowl. Yeah, I mean,
that was
who would have thought?
It was very disappointing.
Well, anybody that bet Hogan you imagine winning? Think about that. So I didn't even think about that until just now. Think about taking Hogan in that bet and winning.
Right.
Zero fucking yards.
Yeah.
And you win and you cash. How embarrassing is it to cash that ticket in on a zero?
I know a guy that would happen.
No, you don't. Yeah, but you can imagine what it'd be like if I did.
I cash that check anyway.
He cashed that ticket and got it on.
Woo!
All
right. That's a bad beat. That one stings, actually.
It is a beat. All right.
So do we care about Gurley and how shitty he did? No. Just
I think it's an injury. I think they're downplaying it. Potential conspiracy theory is that Gurley, and this was just a local guy in Cleveland, said maybe Gurley was less than captivated with the idea of them signing C.J. Anderson, and he showed his displeasure by underperforming. I think that's a long shot. I think there's a difference between being able to practice and play and being 100%, and I don't think he's 100%.
There was a gentleman, Radio Row, I believe is what, you know, they call it. They do press interviews and stuff like that with various players throughout the week leading up to the Super Bowl. And there was a guy in there, he could have been an odds maker or maybe just a sharp bettor. He had snuck in and talked to Gurley, asked him about the Green Bay game, and asked him why he went down early before scoring the touchdown. And he said that some people think that you're cursed. Gurley gave him some smart-ass answer, like, nah, man, those people curse, man. Like, I'm winning, you know, I got money or some shit like that. Todd Gurley, if you're listening to this, you're cursed now, brother. You're cursed now, my man.
Yeah, something's wrong with him. Was he on Madden this year? I don't know.
I hope not, right?
I hope so. Why do I want Todd Gurley to be good?
Yeah, no,
it doesn't help me.
I had him a couple of years ago.
I hope all the bad things in life happen to LeBron James and LeBron James alone. But also, if he's hanging out with Todd Gurley a few of those times and that shit spills over on him, so be it.
That's LeBron James. Perfect transition right there.
Yeah.
So, football is wrapped up until a few months away is the NFL draft.
Where are we at on time? I'm sorry.
We just dinged, so we're ready to...
I kind of want to talk about Jared Goff, just real quick. Can we do this?
Yeah, go ahead.
Spit it over for 5 minutes?
Yeah, spit it out.
I read a theory quite a while ago, several months, definitely several weeks, if not months ago, that potentially the Rams could be the first team that we've ever seen that have a quote-unquote franchise quarterback and decide to move off of him at the end of his rookie contract. And at the time that this theory was suggested, Jared Goff did not have what I think are the question marks that exist surrounding his game today. At the time, his arrow was pointing directly up, but the idea that the Rams have written the new blueprint for how to field a successful football team, and the fact that surrounds or is centered on a rookie quarterback contract, and then you're able to have the defensive players that they had and the players on offense that they were able to pay. So I think it's a very interesting concept that even if Goff was the guy, that again, I don't think he is for the Rams, that they might entertain drafting a quarterback here very soon and moving off of Jared Goff rather than signing him to a mega contract that will hamstring most teams if that guy is not a generational quarterback talent.
I believe if they come off of Goff, it's going to be because Goff isn't that good. I think there was a lot of questions about him after his rookie season. More so...
Jeff Fisher.
No. More so from the aspect of his...
Jeff Fisher. Sorry, I'm going to stop.
No,
that.
His intelligence. And so part of that intelligence is an ability to read a defense, which I feel like you had said earlier, Bill Belichick exploited his inability to read a defense.
Right, so for people that are not hip to this theory, you got to understand, A, that the coach / offensive coordinator is able to communicate with the quarterback up until the play clock, and I keep wanting to say shot clock.
So 15 seconds.
15 seconds. Play clock hits 15, communication is cut off between the coach and the quarterback. And the real genius in L.A. is McVay, and I don't think anybody's disputing that. Mm-hmm. But the lack of football IQ that Jared Goff possesses is something that potentially Bill Belichick exploited in this Super Bowl. And by that, I mean showing your hand on defenses, which I saw a really interesting video. I don't want to go too far down this, but I saw a video with Arlovsky that really kind of hit me to how you can ask a defense what scheme it is that they're about to run on any given play, and they will answer you by you put a player in motion, and if that player's followed, and you can do multiple checks and balances to try to ask a defense what they're about to show you, and then they're going to show you. And what's interesting is, in that Arlovsky video, that defense, and it was the Colts, they were lying to the offense, and they were showing man coverage, and they immediately dropped into zone when the ball was hiked. So what I heard, and what carries a lot of weight in my mind as far as a theory, is that Belichick was waiting until McVay, the guy on that team that's able to read defenses, was no longer able to communicate with Jared Goff, and that Belichick was lying to that offense about what scheme that he was going to run on any given play, and then he was getting incredibly more exotic at the 14-second mark on the play clock and completely confused Jared Goff, who had put up 3 points in that football game. So it's a it's a theory that when you look at the game, it carries a lot of weight.
It's sound. I mean, and it would go with something Belichick does, which is play dead games.
But really, I mean, and that plays into Goff really has been exposed, I believe. My prediction is that Jared Goff is not going to be the quarterback of the Rams 3 years from now.
I don't mind that as a theory, and I would probably tend to agree. I don't know if it's a deliberate thing because they don't want to pay more for the position. I think they don't want to pay Jared Goff more for that position.
And that's where it's unfortunate. I'd love to see Jared Goff be
good somewhere else.
Great, but not excellent, and watch that theory play out, that McVay's confident enough that he can move on to another quarterback. To me, for the sake of that theory, it's unfortunate that Goff is the idiot that he is, because we're never going to get to see if that theory is going to play out, because they are going to move on from him.
So, real quick, tell me who you like next year, AFC, NFC.
Yeah, we're gonna do some quick predictions, just off the cuff. We haven't put a lot of thought into this.
Disclaimer, this is subject to change, pending free agency, and...
This is going to change.
Right? This is going to change.
But it's going to be interesting,
just off the cuff, what do you like?
Our snapshot right now. I'm going to go with, I want to take the Browns. I won't be surprised if they're in the AFC Championship game.
Okay.
But my prediction for the Super Bowl this coming year is Houston Texans. I know you guys don't necessarily believe that, but I know you want to hear it. And on the other side, I think I'm going to go Rams.
Okay.
Texans, very Rams.
Nice. Drew, what do you like?
Probably just go chalk here with Pats, unless Brady's going to hang it up, you know?
Okay.
I mean...
That's fair.
If he's still out there...
Yeah, that's fair.
I don't know. Yeah, I'm not going to keep betting against him at some point. One time during his career,
so Patriots and who?
Wow, NFC, eh? Yeah, I mean, current favorites the Rams right now. So. All
right, so who's gonna win? Patriots, Rams, rematch.
Yeah, I'm gonna go back with Brady.
Patriots, okay. Yeah.
Patriots, interesting. All right, so.
What about you?
In the AFC, I like the Colts. Right, they got a lot of money to spend. They got good defensive players. They got a good guy make the draft picks. And they've got a really good quarterback.
Yeah, but he just didn't look right. In the, I mean,
look. You look at what Belichick has done to him throughout the years, and he often looks his worst against Belichick.
Okay, so you're saying Colts.
I don't necessarily see the Colts having to go through the Patriots next season. The Patriots like to do the on and off. Them 2 years in a row is rare.
Colts and who?
So in the NFC, man, I think it's lazy to pick the Rams. Because the Rams have McVay and they're good. Their defense was good. I don't see them really necessarily being able to really duplicate this again on the defensive side, mostly because Wade Phillips traditionally doesn't have back-to-back.
So who you got?
I do like the Saints. I think what the Saints have overall is better. And I think they were robbed, and I think Drew Brees is going to come out like a man on fire.
So I'm gonna make a one bold prediction right now that I'm gonna firmly stick by, regardless of what happens in the draft and free agency. And the caveat is that Le'Veon Bell does not sign with the Colts. Assuming Le'Veon Bell does not sign with the Colts, two of these three teams are going to be in the AFC Championship game, and it's Patriots, Chiefs, Browns. Pardon me. Chiefs, Texans, Browns is what I meant to say.
I believe that.
Two of those three teams are going to be in the AFC Championship game. Chiefs, Texans, Browns.
Oh, Chiefs, Texans, Browns. So, I mean, Chiefs for sure.
I'm just saying two of those three teams.
Texans will probably end up in the playoffs, yes.
No, I'm making a very specific bold prediction, and I'm going to leave it at that. Yeah.
No, that's an
Chiefs, Texans, game. Browns.
All right.
That's what I meant
Fair
to
enough.
Say.
Fair enough, he says.
So let's put football season to rest. It was a great season.
Oh, we'll also talk about it again next
year. Better like next year. Let's talk about basketball, man.
Basketball.
Basketball's been going crazy. I know my Twitter's been blowing up. Thank you, Woj, for never sleeping, apparently.
You got that time. It's going.
So, man, the biggest thing, I'm going to let you hit this topic. Because this is near and dear to you. Talk about it.
It's near and dear to me. So, Anthony
Davis.
Let
it all out.
Yeah.
All right? This is your forum.
Let this be cathartic.
We should get a couch and let him lay down on it.
It's not going to be cathartic because I'm never...
It's never going to be okay.
It's never
going to
be okay again.
You're going to show us where it touched
me. It's never going to be okay.
Yeah, where it touched
me. I'm going to show you on the doll where LeBron James touched me.
That's right.
And hurt me.
Show us where he hurt you.
And betrayed me. And lied to me and told me that he wasn't going to hurt me. And then
your doll doesn't
immediately,
have a soul.
He hurt me while he was saying, I'm not going to hurt you. And then he was hurting me at that same time. So it's hard to believe anybody. It's hard to believe anybody anymore, to be honest with you. What were we talking about? No, I'm just kidding. So Anthony Davis did not move. He did not change residence. And I, for one, applaud and am enamored with the New Orleans Pelicans franchise right now. There's a story that came out, and it's very interesting. It was on a podcast, but it was a LeBron insider who's been with LeBron since high school, Brian Windhorst, who broke the story or dropped the theory, although he's very specific. How did he phrase it, Drew?
So he said that it's not what they were trying to do, it's what they did.
So Brian Windhorst said with 100% certainty that this is what happened, not theoretical. The Pelicans, let me back up a little bit. An article came out in the last 48 hours stating that the Pelicans tampered
The Lakers tampered.
No. The article came out that said the Pelicans tampered in a brand new way that's never been done before, that's not against the rules, but is absolutely phenomenal and fascinating. So the theory that Windhorst says is unequivocally what happened, is that the Pelicans, after LeBron James and Rich Paul tampered in an attempt to pry Anthony Davis free from the Pelican organization to the Lakers, the Pelicans were not having that shit. And the Pelicans engaged in trade talks with the Lakers, all the while never intending at any point to make a trade with the Lakers. And meanwhile, every offer that the Lakers made to the Pelicans, the Pelicans leaked that data to reporters of all shapes and sizes so as to get the stories out, so as to create a major rift, which has now exists, by the way, in the Laker organization. There's some serious issues that did not exist a week ago in the Los Angeles Laker organization, and the idea is that the Pelicans maliciously and purposely engaged in trade talks that they never intended to follow through with so that they could leak these stories and destroy and watch the Lakers eat themselves from the inside out, which is now happening, by the way. And if that's true, my new favorite basketball team, New Orleans Pelicans.
So, look, this has gotten so bad for the Lakers that other NBA teams are starting to troll Laker players. Drew, talk about that.
Yeah, so it was the Pacers-Lakers game yesterday. Let's see, it was Tuesday. Final score, 136-94.
Woo!
It was
an Oladipo-less.
An Oladipo-less
Pacers team. That's very important to know. Handed LeBron James the worst loss of his professional career.
It is the second largest defeat by a Lakers organization in history. So largest is 49 in Dallas.
It's not insane. So not only did they get blown out.
So they at the line. So yeah, at the line they had chants ringing down from the crowd. LeBron wants to trade you to various players.
Not Lakers want to trade you.
LeBron wants to trade you.
So I've got.
But first of all, bravo to the Pacer fans. Yeah. You get an A for creativity.
Absolutely. So I've gotten some unique perspective on this because I spent a lot of time listening to Cleveland Sports Talk Radio, Cleveland, Ohio, not Cleveland, Texas. I don't think Cleveland, Texas has Sports Talk Radio.
I think
it's just Houston radio.
I think you'd be surprised.
All right, yeah. I'd be surprised by anything. But it's interesting when you really start to break this down on a micro, incident by incident, piece by piece basis, because LeBron James, and this is maybe a take that you guys hadn't considered, was always able to push and dump blame off on Dan Gilbert in Cleveland. Right. He was always able to make Dan Gilbert the fall guy, to blame Dan Gilbert for everything that went wrong. It was Dan Gilbert's fault that team went from a 2016 championship to completely dismantled a year and a half later. All of that was Gilbert's fault. Everybody, nationally and locally in Cleveland, ate that shit up. LeBron could do no wrong. Dan Gilbert was the problem. LeBron was able to walk away from that situation, guilt, blame, and mostly blemish-free. I got news for LeBron James, who I know is not listening to this podcast, so you can relay this to him if you know the guy that does his dry cleaning. Laker fans are not. I'm gonna look at the camera for this one. Laker fans are not turning on Magic Johnson as this whole fucking shit house goes up in flames. LeBron James is about to get a rude awakening for what it means to square off with a legend, an icon. I mean, is anybody more important to the Laker organization than Magic Johnson? We can argue that maybe somebody is, but it's really easy to defuse all those arguments and come back to my statement that Magic Johnson is the Laker. He is the king of Lakertown, of Lakerland, whatever you want to say. The fans are not going to side with LeBron James. They're not going to turn on Magic. So LeBron James, he's got some serious problems on his hands right now. And I, for one, am sitting back like Michael Jackson, just eating popcorn, just drinking this in. This is the greatest show on earth for me right now.
That was Terrell that ate the popcorn.
This is the greatest, the number one popcorn eating meme is Michael Jackson.
I think
Jackson
that
from the beginning of the Thriller video.
Two takes on that. Like, the younger generation is fans of players and not so much teams or organizations, right? Whereas
Trey, we're getting that
older
popcorn scene with Michael Jackson.
Exactly.
It's a GIF. I mean,
it's a GIF. Yeah, like older generation.
You would be wrong. I love that we're about to get into this, but let's not.
Can we put a poll up above our heads?
We're going to talk about this after the podcast is done being recorded. It is GIF. The creator of GIF has stated that it's GIF.
Fair enough.
Okay.
I've said GIF my whole life. So.
It's GIF. That is correct.
No. I've said GIF.
I've said GIF my whole life.
It's GIF.
I don't know. Shit. Now you're confusing me. What the fuck was I saying my whole life?
GIF.
GIF is peanut butter.
Yeah, giraffe.
GIF. Maybe I was
giraffe doesn't start with a J. It starts with a G. Giraffe.
Freaking our tongue samples. Hooked on phonics, my ass.
Not all words that start with G are pronounced with a soft G, but there's a precedent in giraffe.
If we didn't need that mic, I would say drop that bitch.
There's a precedent.
I mean, that shut me down, dude. It's
It's not the only way to hit your G, but that's a precedent that you can cite. Huh? And the creator of GIF, I was shamed into the truth. I was shamed into the truth a couple of years ago that it is in fact GIF. But there's a Michael Jackson GIF eating popcorn. There's other examples of guys eating popcorn, but the Michael Jackson one is the most.
Can we get GIF popcorn? Is that a thing?
Jiffy Pop.
Jiffy Pop.
Man!
But it starts with a J.
Yes. Yeah.
I completely ruined my theory.
Sorry. Yeah. So, no popcorn for you.
Wait, well, where we just got real
off top
sidetracked.
GIFs and GIFs.
This segment of the podcast brought to you by Short Attention Spans.
What were we talking about?
Bad memes.
We were talking about basketball, but I don't know.
And now we're working with our sponsors.
Yeah, what is, who's our sponsor?
Do you have a child at home that's having trouble paying attention? Try more sugar.
We got a good sponsor lined up. It was,
drink some alcohol.
The club, right?
All right, so we were talking about LeBron. We were talking about you. Here's where we left off. Drew was talking about how this younger generation is and are fans of players and not teams.
Right.
That actually lends itself to LeBron being okay in the way that he's
conducting himself. Right, so exactly. So that's why there's going to be, you know, conflict within the city. So that's just, it adds fuel to the fire, right? Because there are LeBron fans there that are LeBron fans.
But check this out. I actually can tie this into the joke that I just made. We live in an age where everybody's got a short attention. Everybody has a short attention span, right? So it's great that people are fans of players and not teams, and LeBron is the GOAT in a lot of people's minds, but those people all have fucking short attention spans, and LeBron and this hamstring linger too much longer, they're going to fucking move on to something else real quick. Whatever it is, I don't give a shit.
They're very quickly fading into obscurity this season.
But LeBron, if LeBron's not careful, the thing that he's been able to capitalize on, which is people being fans of players instead of teams, is going to turn around and bite him in the ass because people are going to move on from Bron, and they're going to be...
What do you think if he doesn't, for the first time in his career, make the playoffs?
What do I think?
You
can go to New Orleans. Did you know that you can go to New Orleans and you can go to City Hall and you can get a permit and have your own parade? Did you know this? Inexpensive and they send police and you can have... I'm flying people down from Ohio and we are having a parade if LeBron James... If he doesn't make the playoffs in Los Angeles, it is complete and total vindication for anybody that's ever rooted for the Cleveland Cavaliers. Vindication! Freedom!
There's levels of petty, right? There's levels to this shit. And when you're talking about going to NOLA to throw a parade,
you know,
this is not petty.
People in Cleveland.
This is not petty. See, you
because LeBron's in LA.
Look, you need to look up.
I appreciate the reason to have definition. A party. Do me a favor.
Oh, no, I'm all about it. I'll be there. It's not about that. I'll be there for sure.
Parade in New Orleans. Not only will I be there,
but
we'll be picking up more Yuengling and bringing it.
You guys are going to be there. We're going to be drinking Yuengling.
Not sell this in Texas.
And we can record a podcast live from the parade. Or at least a little...
Just do it right there. Right on the flow. We'll get a flow.
We'll get a little cut. Yeah, so Anthony Davis did not move. The Pelicans potentially tampered in a legal way that I think is absolutely fantastic. I teased this last week. The evil that exists in the NBA right now, we teased this on last week's podcast, and we were going to talk about it this week, and that evil is Rich Paul and LeBron James having a financial stake in his agency, right?
Right.
And the fact that he technically, if you want to get down to brass tacks, is Anthony Davis's agent. Like, it doesn't get more tampery than that, right? So the I'm glad, for one, I'm relieved and grateful that the Pelicans are not going to just bow down to the terroristic organization that is Clutch Sports. Rich Paul has been strong-arming NBA franchises, not multiple NBA franchises, into executing his bidding, and the Pelicans have said that they've had enough. And I've had enough, so...
I think there's something to say about the player himself demanding the trade with so much team control left.
Right.
I feel like that was... It's almost an egregious demand in a way. I get it, right? Not wanting to play in a specific place anymore. Being forced into a situation. I get it.
He wasn't. But he signed that contract.
No, like, you're right.
He's getting paid.
I was wrong last week. Before you go any further, I was wrong last week. He's not under team control through 2021. That is a player option. So I thought it was 2 years.
He has next year on the books.
A full year. I was thinking up until a few days ago that he had 2 years and the rest of the
season.
That's
why they're looking
for him. Okay, just want to make sure you guys knew that. Because I mistakenly stated that last week.
No, we knew it was 2021. That's what we looked it up, yeah.
This is adding to the fuel with Rich Paul is he had coerced, he had coerced AD into adding a couple teams to his list.
Right.
Okay. So there were only two teams on the list, the Lakers and the Knicks, all right? Those were the only two teams. So he was advised by his agent, add a couple more teams. So he added Milwaukee.
The teams that had no
and LA room. Clippers.
Mm-hmm.
And him being his agent, Rich Paul, he knew already, before specifically naming those teams, that those teams had zero possibility of being able to execute a trade to land Anthony Davis.
The Pelicans have played this right at every turn. I don't know. Do we have anything else to say about this?
The other thing is the Pelicans made a lot of moves, and you look at the moves, and they're not necessarily terrible, terrible moves. I think the biggest problem in the NBA is there's too much money going around. There's not enough really good players that are worth the money, and even if you have all this cap space and draft capital... there's so few players that are great that are drafted, and there's so few players that are great that are in the league that, I mean, cap space.
What
is
you just explained is how Timothy Mozgov ends up with $100 million,
right.
How Ryan Anderson ends up with
$80 million. And it also explains
you're forced to spend that money.
It also explains why there is no, you name me. A trade. Name me a return for Anthony Davis, and
it's
I don't care.
That
I don't care. Seven first rounders and a playable commodity that exists right now. Still not worth trading Anthony Davis.
Look, honestly,
there's
honestly,
no trade.
I feel like getting Kristaps Porzingis for Anthony Davis instead of nothing would have been pretty good. And I think over anything Boston could have given him. I think they should have taken Kristaps. And that was dumb to...
Knicks.
Not. Yeah, the Knicks.
They Knicks'd that.
Yeah,
the
Knicks
trade.
That one again.
So it takes two sides to trade. So somebody wasn't into that trade going down, or it would have gone down. And I heard also, by the way...
I heard that the Knicks didn't even shop him around.
Didn't entertain all offers,
anything.
Right.
They didn't explore any other offers.
Right, so maybe they liked Dennis Smith.
The Mavs came with this, and they were like, yeah, all right.
Maybe they like Dennis Smith. Maybe they definitely wanted those two max spots. There's
yeah,
a lot of...
so they got DeAndre Jordan out of this, and I was reading that he's potentially a buyout guy.
Right.
Someone who said he wants to play in Houston.
Did y'all...
Wayne Ellington is a buyout guy. Someone I think the Rockets should look at.
Decent shooter.
Yeah.
Did y'all hear Kevin Durant today, by the way? Because we didn't talk about this.
Was it today or the yesterday?
Was it his rant on the media?
His rant on the media.
Yeah, that was yesterday.
Okay, so, real quick, we didn't plan on talking about this, but it just popped into my head. Kevin Durant attacked a room full of media members because of one story written by a guy from The Athletic who reports on the Warriors. involving potentially Kevin Durant
leaving the Warriors.
Leaving the Warriors, but Kevin Durant potentially having an awareness slash a hand in the Knicks trading Porzingis to free up those max cap slots. And the article, I believe, suggested that without outright stating it. And he went off. First of all, he's been silent to the entire...
Yeah, like 9 days or something like that.
Right, to everybody. And this is an interesting thing.
It's an immediate blackout.
If anybody in the media writes a negative article about a player, the tendency is for them to shut everybody in the media out, which is a pretty unfair way to try to, you know, that's some vigilante justice that the punishment doesn't fit the crime as far as I'm concerned. But when he finally came back and actually talked today and was kind of goaded into talking, he attacked the media member who wrote the story about, you know, will he be going to New York after the season is over? And his take is, I just want to play basketball. I don't want to be talking about this. I've told you guys already, like, you're manufacturing these stories. And here's what happened with me today. I was with Durant the whole time. I saw the clip multiple times. My thought process was, he's right. Like, you don't create turmoil and panic amongst the fans, and don't do...
Yeah, I mean, you're talking about June in...
And he just wants to play, and they got to worry about playing right now. But I heard a singular thought near the end of the day that completely flipped my perception on its head. And that thought was that Kevin Durant chose to remain flexible by signing these one-and-ones. And he, therefore, is responsible for
creating
it. He's created a situation where the media cannot write a story about a basketball player that the fans don't want to read, because if the fans aren't reading it,
they're not doing these one-and-ones to create the free agency drama. They're doing it to capitalize on the newer TV money,
but a byproduct,
bigger salary caps.
Right.
There's a trickle down effect
that's happening throughout the league because of it, though. So personally, for him, it's for the money. But it's bigger than that. Like,
your
scope of
your take suggests that somebody that gets drunk and drives their car, less responsible for any harm that they may create in the world
My take is that these writers on ESPN, these guys have a job to do, which is manufacture a story 24/7. That's easy to say. Hey, we want to talk about your free agency that's coming up now. Even though he's not a free agent today. So technically, him talking about free agency today is not allowed.
But here's the timeline of how this went down. That story was written.
He can attack that.
What do you get?
That's his right to attack.
Let me break the timeline down for you really quick, just so we're clear.
But I don't care.
That story. But it matters. It's relevant. That story was written. Reporters did not ask him about that story.
The dude asked him right after the game. He said, "What is your intentions for free agency in June?"
When did the guy ask him that?
After the game last night. And the answer was, I'm not talking about it.
That's not how it went. Somebody wrote a story 2 weeks ago. He shut the media out for 2 weeks without anybody having asked him a question. And today, or last night, the media member said, "Why are you not talking to us?" And he just wouldn't talk. He's like, "What's going on here? Did we do something wrong?" Wouldn't say anything. And after multiple inquiries, the guy finally said, "Is it because of the story that was written about the impending free agency?" And it's not manufactured when your own teammate, who cried in the car and asked you to come play on his team, told you to go fuck yourself. We don't need you. We know you're leaving after the season anyway. This is a story that's been bubbling and brewing based on the behavior of the team. This is not manufactured. Like, potentially Kevin Durant is leaving that team, and that is a story. These players they're responsible for talking to the media before and after every basketball game and at least once on practice days. That's part of the reason they make millions of dollars.
Talk about the game that we just played, right? Don't ask me about my free agency today in February.
Again, that guy didn't ask him about his free agency. He's trying to figure out why he wasn't talking to the media. And it was like the fifth question in the line of questions is it because of this?
And he just answered so that by saying, I can't trust you guys. I don't trust you guys. Right. What he told them.
Right.
So I'm not talking to you anymore. I don't trust you. All right. But this is not the first time that he's hated on the media. Like, this, his whole career, and,
you know,
he's
best,
hated the media.
You know the best part about
he's
this?
He's come out and been like, fuck y'all.
You know the last thing he said in that, at the end of his rant? This is so golden. It's I'm too excited to even say it right now. The last thing he said was, you need to grow up.
Yeah,
you
know? He pointed at the
and
guy.
And he pointed at the guy and he said, I'm talking to you. You need to grow
up.
The guy who just
singled him out.
The guy who just told a room full of people that they need to grow up after he gave them the 5-year-old silent treatment for 2 weeks is the guy who's got 5 fucking Twitter burner accounts because he can't handle being an adult. That's the guy we're talking about right now.
He can't handle being a grown-ass man who makes millions of dollars, who anyone can write and say whatever the fuck they want to say about him, and he's got to just take it. Because he can't say, hey, you, fat dude who doesn't know how to play basketball, why the fuck are you trying to criticize my goddamn game? Right?
That was one of his better tweets.
No, that's the reality of it. These dudes are people with fucking feelings, right? Yes, the shit cunt, whatever, Tom Brady,
right,
has a wife who really fucking loves him and a daughter who gets to call Gronky, right? But you think he's a shit cunt because he wins.
That's not why I think
he's
a shit cunt.
Oh, I'm sorry, because he cheats, right?
That's not why I said it either.
All right.
I told you very specifically that people that are shitty and are outwardly shitty, I have a great deal of respect for. And if you want to paint yourself as a saint and you're a piece of shit.
But Kevin Durant, not liking what somebody wrote, saying that it's causing unnecessary noise in his locker room, is not unentitled to fucking voice that opinion. And if he wants to tell the dude who wrote that, who caused the rift, yeah, you need to grow up. He's well within his rights. And what's really fucked up is, just like that dude has the right to fucking write that, he has the right to tell that dude that.
He does, but
absolutely.
But does he not need to look at the causation for the story?
The causation for his attitude is the fucking story.
The causation for his attitude is not the story.
No, it's
the causation for his attitude
is trying to capitalize on free agency and the rules that they have in free agency and the stupid fucking TV money and the ever escalating salary cap. He's trying to get paid. Why wouldn't you want to get paid the most you can get paid to do the job that you're going to do anyway? That dude's going to show up and play basketball anyway. So why not
every
couple of years sign a new contract to maximize your contract?
Nobody criticized him for wanting to get paid.
Okay, but you're saying that he's manufacturing the story because he's doing these one-on-ones.
I never said anybody manufactured anything. The story exists because it's real and tangible. It's happening. It's causing...
But someone making up a story that he wants to go to New York to make a fucking narrative when he's saying, I didn't say that. I'm trying to play basketball. Stop making shit up.
Oh, okay. So let's talk...
But the reality is he is a free agent coming up, and New York does have a lot of cap space. So people want to add one and one together and put this shit like he's saying,
or,
it, but he's not.
That's your perception of what's going on here. Or most reporters... It's an anomaly for a reporter to just make something up. It's more likely that reporter talked to people in the know, in and around Kevin Durant, and he got the truth, and Kevin Durant didn't like that he discovered the truth
and reported the fucking truth,
and Kevin Durant didn't like it, so he chose to act like a child because he didn't like that the truth got out. That's much more likely than a reporter just carelessly risking his livelihood fucking making stories up.
Fair enough. So it is well within Kevin Durant's right to say, I don't like that you're reporting that shit that's fucking private.
And Kevin Durant's real issue is that his intentions have created turmoil in his locker room. His intentions and his behavior have created that turmoil, and he's lashing out at someone that's simply doing their job writing about the turmoil. But it's his actions that have created it, and then he's fucking mad at the guy instead of himself and Draymond Green.
No.
He should be mad at Draymond Green and himself, not at
the
reporter.
As a reporter, you have to understand the rules of fucking life that were bestowed to you when you were in kindergarten. That snitches get stitches and end up in ditches. If you're going to fucking tell people secrets, right? If you tell people secrets, they're going to come after your ass.
And if you are a reporter and you don't tell people secrets, you end up a beat reporter for the Colorado Avalanche
or
for your entire fucking life.
Podcast.
For your entire life. So you come on, dude.
No, just
Kevin Durant needs to.
Dude has every right to write the article, right? But Kevin Durant has every right to not like it.
No, they're both.
And not have
they're
to
both
do
in the right. It's just funny on both ends, right? But there is substance to this. About 4 weeks ago, three, 4 weeks ago, Enes Kanter did send out a tweet. Who was cut today before the deadline?
Right.
Who's no longer in the Knicks?
I wouldn't mind that.
They did. He did say, in all caps or some shit like that, "You won't believe who's going to be here next year." Okay, that organization knows something. All right, there's a reason that they did not entertain a trade offer with New Orleans to try to get Anthony Davis to give them the number one pick.
Right.
Because they can pair up Zion Williamson with Durant, Kyrie, Kemba Walker, who's a great scorer, who's never played with other All-Stars, who's going to be a free agent this year. Mm-hmm. There's options on the table. The Knicks are a dumpster fire and have been for 20 years.
But they're about to not be.
That division, that division is going to be one of the stoutest divisions in the NBA.
Well,
you're going to have Philly, New York, and Boston all killing each other for those top three, four spots.
When I spoke
last week,
Boston's
about to get better when Kyrie's out of the picture.
When I spoke ill last week of New York Knicks, I did not know that.
No, we've been speaking ill of the Knicks for.
I was going to read an article that said they are the most valuable NBA franchise.
Yes.
At over $4 billion.
Yeah.
This is a 20-year losing season.
You can throw anything up there. It doesn't matter.
And it's a $4 billion.
And it's
team.
And that team is
crazy.
About to be live 2 years from now.
I mean,
that
we'll see what happens. Because again, right?
Live.
Just because you have cap space doesn't mean someone.
No, but it helps to be in New
York.
It
doesn't
mean
you're the right person.
So,
but they are better than a long shot.
So I just my final thought on the Durant thing, and I'm glad that I brought this up because this was
the Durant.
My final thought on it is the reporter was in the right doing his job. Durant was in his right not accepting the reporter doing his job, but Durant was in the wrong shutting out the entire gamut.
That's fair,
right? And it was reporters in the room that were tired of being shut out, that goaded him into finally saying what was really wrong.
That's how he handles himself, right? Like this is not the first time, again, he's gotten into rifts with reporters before and he's handled it similar.
No.
Not the same way, but very similar.
Which is why there's such just a delicious irony in the fact that he said grow up when he doesn't know the first thing about being a man.
All right.
Hook him.
So
we're gonna hope to have Kevin Durant on the podcast.
Yeah,
so
next year, under the name George.
All right, so we're about to wrap this up, y'all.
I want to say one last thing.
It's not over yet.
Okay. All right. There's one other topic I want to talk about very quickly.
Is it NBA?
It is NBA.
Go ahead. Hit your NBA.
Okay. Quick. So I was talking to you guys in pre-production about the things that the Cavs have done, and we're obviously the laughing stock of the NBA. But Kobe Altman. And I'm just going to read this off a tweet because I wanted to get very specific about who the players were that he moved, right? Kobe Altman, the general manager of the Cavs, pretty green as far as experience up until getting this job. He just turned George Hill, Kyle Korver, and Rodney Hood into 6 additional second-round picks, 2 additional first-round picks. The Cavs are going to probably have a 14% chance to get Zion in the lottery, right? We're going to be free and clear. He not only, what isn't contained in that tweet is that he got the Cavs finally, after years of penalty, under the tax penalty line, right? He manufactured all this draft capital, which we agree is not necessarily incredibly valuable, especially those second rounders, but they do retain a tremendous amount more value before the picks are made.
They fly around in this weird salary.
Right.
And dump.
So, in addition, one of the things that sparked us getting the Rockets' first-round pick was taking on that awful Brandon Knight contract.
Terrible Brandon Knight.
Which was a salary dump.
$15 million next season.
So, we traded. Terrible. Who's the guy that we traded? That's not...
Iman Shumpert?
No,
Shumpert came from the Kings.
We traded.
Oh, it was a Baldwin. And
you were worried about the Rockets
Stastis.
Taking the guy on
because
he wasn't. No,
no.
There was a guy that the Rockets ended up not even taking.
Alex
on.
Alec Burks.
Alec Burks was the expiring contract that created the value for the Cavaliers. So we traded an expiring contract and got a first round pick back, in addition to Marquez Chris, who's only 22 years old.
Young kid.
Right?
And he was decent. He just wanted more playing
time. And the thing that everything I stated thus far, people have already been talking about. The thing that people are not talking a lot about is that salary dumping Brandon Knight becomes a valuable commodity in an expiring contract next season. So Kobe Altman has done a bang up job in a very short period of time. I think the Cavs rebuild is going to happen. And now the caveat is that nobody wants to fucking play in Cleveland. So it's going to be very interesting how they, but you know, the model that was cited today that you'll appreciate on local Cleveland radio, Kyrie didn't want to play there. Apparently he always wanted to be out of there. The model that they cited was Daryl Morey. Daryl Morey stacked all those draft picks, and then he pounced on James Harden when the opportunity presented itself. And that's how the Cavs are going to build a potentially competitive franchise.
It's going to be through trades
and through the draft. And Kobe Altman has quickly stacked the Cavs commodity cabinet in very short order. And nobody's talking about it right now. And nobody cares much. But we're going to revisit this conversation in a few years if Kobe Altman can successfully flip that capital into something by a long court.
I mean,
it's interesting.
Good job getting stuff that could be something.
I mean, we have four first-round picks in the next 2 years. That is definitely something.
This is a very good draft class this year, so we'll see what comes
right.
So last topics. No more Cleveland basketball.
No, it wasn't Cleveland basketball. It was about how often this is a topic maybe we cover in the future. There's a breakdown
of
the success that is had with different slots in the draft, and it's interesting. All right.
Last thing, pitchers and catchers are reporting baseball. We're actually going to see baseball games on TV within the next couple, 2-3 weeks.
If you're really hungry for baseball, the Caribbean Classic's going on right now, ESPN Deportes.
That is
Cuba taking on the Dominican.
On the unofficial.
I just lost my appetite.
Mexico taking on Panama.
So,
with pitchers
and catchers reporting, spring training is about to get going. I think it's important to talk real quick about the two biggest free agents. Going into free agency, everybody was talking about it. Neither one of them were signed, and it's a freaking trash.
I mean, the two biggest free agencies in
baseball.
In a couple of years, too, not just. And then
first of all, Harper might be a once-in-a-generation type team.
What does Harper have, one 100 RBI season? I think he might be over.
Overrated?
He might be overrated. He's definitely overrated. He's got some shit cut potential, by
he's
the way.
He's also a bitch.
As well.
If you looked at his Twitter, he was telling fans to stay out of it, right?
That's a clown question, bro.
Oh, just goddamn.
Who's the reliever that he got into a fist fight with him in the dugout?
Oh yeah, that was
a former Astro?
No, that was fuck it.
I keep wanting to say Kimbrel, but it was
No, it was one of their reliefs closers. Kimbrel. Really good. It started with an S, right?
He bounced all over, but he was really good. He was with Boston. He was Boston's closer for a long time.
Yeah.
And ended up in Washington and then Philly. What's his name? Anyways, yeah. So really interesting, specifically
Strickland.
No. Baseball free agency, what's really fascinating.
Papelbon.
Thank you.
Yeah. Jonathan Papelbon.
Free agents, almost exclusively, the free agent cycle in any sport is the big chips fall, the big dominoes topple, and then everything else
falls
in quick succession. So some smaller dominoes have been slowly but surely falling, and meanwhile, these two big daddies are just standing. And, you know, we're pitchers and catchers reporting. We don't know where these guys are going to play this year. Aaron, you had an interesting take on the potential for collusion / ownership trying to shift the direction.
I feel like ownership, I don't feel, it's been said that the owners have been unwilling to even engage in these contract talks for 10 years, $400 million, wanting to contract the way these big contracts have been doled out over the last few years. You look at the way they end up, in the back years of these contracts when a lot of these things are backloaded, and you end up paying an Albert Pujols, you know, $30 million a season, and he's not producing like he was when he was a $30 million a year guy.
Yeah, A-Rod's the
look, there's still Bobby Bonilla Day for the New York Mets.
Well, there's a lot. We could dedicate a whole episode to Bobby Bonilla.
We should one day, because it's fucking fascinating.
It's fascinating.
Fascinating.
And the potential exists that the Mets did the right thing and came out on top.
Absolutely.
For the way especially, that they handled that. As crazy as it sounds.
Given how much money they lost to Madoff and what it really did to their finances, I mean, really, that thing was kind of easy for them to handle.
And what they were potentially able to do with that money.
Crazy.
Really fascinating. But interesting that we don't know where Harper and Machado are going to play. There's been speculation that this could lead to potentially a lawsuit from the Players Association against the owners for collusion. If the market value for Bryce Harper is 10 years, $300 million, and he ends up with a three-year, $80 million contract, then that'll be very interesting legally to watch that play out.
I think the price per season, I think, is going to really be where the owners kind of dig in their heels, saying, look, we'll give you what you want per season, we just don't want to give it to you for 10 years.
Right.
And so it'll be hard to prove that as collusion over good business, right?
I don't think it's a lawsuit that the Players Association wins, but it could lead to some really serious ill will.
If they're offering a ten-year, $200 million contract, and neither one of our budget off of those type of contract numbers, that would be a collusion type driving the price of the player down.
Yeah, I don't think it's a lawsuit that they could win, but it's going to lead to some bad blood leading to the next collective bargaining agreement.
Yeah, might get another strike.
So it's so counterintuitive. You touched on something really interesting. I won't go too deep into this. It's so counterintuitive to think that these baseball contracts, for the most part, for the majority of the length of these long-term deals, they are paying these players for previous production.
Right.
Whereas a lot of times these players are on the rookie wage scale. They're minor league.
For the prime of their
production. All of their production. Yeah. I think it ends up being balanced and fair that the players are backloaded on their careers. But it's not often the team that drafted them that got all the value that's then paying for the sins of the father, if you will, right? So it's a broken system that needs to be fixed. But the Yankees, I have no interest in Machado, they were the odds on favorite to land
the
him.
The owners collude all the time. They just do it legally through arbitration and control and player control and keeping the player in the minors until June 1st. excuse me, call ups. Those little tricks that they do, not having them on opening day roster, assert team control for longer. And honestly, when you look at the reason the NFL and the NBA are the preferred sports for kids, and you look at the potential to be successful a year or so after high school in the NBA, or a couple years after high school, in football versus you're 28, 27, 26 years old by the time you make it through the minor leagues. Forget about if you went to college and played for 3 or 4 years, right? I mean, the path to professional baseball and the professional baseball money is so long and arduous, it's just not worth it.
Kyler Murray is about to break the system even further than it's already broken.
Because
I think he's leveraging football that obviously at 5'7" and a half, he's not. I mean,
The Dolphins are slated to pick in the
draft. This is a whole other topic.
They're like picking in 10th.
We don't have enough time to get into this because of the risk that he could go play baseball, that suggests that he's going to fall further down in the draft. And the later you draft him, the greater the risk becomes because he's going to get less guaranteed money, and that's going to shift him more likely to baseball. So if you're not drafting him...
If baseball is going to give be granted, if they're going to grant the A's the exception to pay him beyond what...
He's going
to
leverage the NFL situation into that happening, I predict, because no team's going to risk a top 10 pick on Kyler Murray. Because that pick evaporates.
I believe that pick evaporates.
He's 5'7.5". No team is going to take him in the top 10, and the risk, it compounds on itself as it gets later into the draft. So
where
does is going to waste a pick? It's almost for sure a waste.
Where does Michonne end up?
So
and where does
so
Bryce Harper end up?
So then you're telling me that the Patriots are going to take Kyler Murray in the sixth round, and he's going to whisper
is
to
the
Robert
one,
Crossier.
That was when I heard someone talking about this today. If the Patriots were to draft Kyler Murray with the 32nd pick in the draft, that's about as late, realistically, as he could be drafted and end up
actually playing
for that organization.
I think there's probably 15 teams in between there where they could draft him and he wouldn't show up.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's going to be fascinating. Where does Machado end up?
And where does Harper end up?
Between Machado and Harper, one of those guys is going to be a Philadelphia Philly, and I predict that
the
other one is a Los Angeles Dodger.
One's a Philly, one's a Dodger.
And I don't know,
Harper sent out a cryptic tweet yesterday that stated that his favorite ballpark to play in is AT&T Park in San Francisco.
He has a meeting with them.
Yeah, and they're willing to pay up whatever. So,
I'm glad you told me that after you asked me.
Who came off the books for San Francisco that's going to allow this?
Barry Zito, was that?
They had that team assembled. They had kept that World Series team together for so long that... They finally started letting pieces go.
Okay.
Basically, the only guy left is going to be...
signed, not 100 pence.
Tim Lincecum?
No, the only guy left is going to be Buster Posey. I had trouble thinking of his name. Everybody else is expendable.
I
want to
call Buster only.
So I think that team... I think it's going to be a
Busters.
I think they're going to have a two-man batting order. It's going to be Buster Posey, Bryce Harper,
and then they'll just go back and forth.
And Ghost Man on second. Back to Buster Posey.
He's stealing.
They're both hitting over 300.
He's on third now.
I didn't see that coming, but I did. Yeah. So then I think Machado's a Philly.
Yeah.
And Harper's a Giant.
But one of the Machado's preferred landing spots is the White Sox, actually. So we'll see. It's like it's anybody.
I don't see that. I can't.
It's anybody's.
I don't know.
They've got money and space.
I think the where they end up is going to be where
at least sexy. All right.
If you're looking at a team that's willing to spend upwards of like what, like $200-$300
right,
million, Chicago is near the top of that list. The White Sox.
Knowing what a punk Manny Machado has come across as over the past several years, and how flashy he enjoys
being.
Who
was the manager there when
the
Astros
released him? Who's the least sexy?
But he's not there anymore.
What's the least sexy organization in all of Major League Baseball? I would suggest that it might be the White Sox.
Yeah, they're up there.
The least sexy.
Indians or Royals.
You want to fucking...
You want to die today?
You want to die at this table?
Say it again. I bet you won't say it again.
Chris?
Fucking Indians?
It's got to
be Indians.
It's got to be the White Sox, so that's where he wants to play.
Show me the money!
Honestly, I think whoever is going to play in this movie.
I think it'll be the Phillies.
At this point.
Depends. If it's about the money and he doesn't give a shit about playing, White Sox are probably near the top of that list. If it's actually about competing for, titles,
if the Phillies can come
MVPs,
correct financially and be a desirable competitive
relevant.
Team. And they did just trade for one of the best catchers in baseball.
Yeah. No,
Aaron's favorite player.
What's
yours
that,
and mine.
What's that dude's name again?
I think it's
ladies
JT.
And gentlemen.
I believe it's your favorite and my favorite.
Real Muto.
JT.
I think it's
Real Muto.
Real Muto.
I believe it's JT.
We're probably the phonetics are wrong there.
So real quick, I saw
top five catcher in baseball, which is
Lance McCullers talking today, right? And so when he was finished up his interview, he was like, "Yeah, I gotta get out of here. I got a Spanish lesson, right?" And the dude was like, "You're learning Spanish?" And he was like, "Yeah, man." He's like, "Breaks." Breaks talk Spanish to everybody. It helps in the clubhouse. Mm-hmm. And I was like, dude, that is the fucking most genius
Breggers.
Thing.
Hey, you didn't know that?
Yeah, well, I knew Bregman's no Spanish, but I didn't know, like...
That's how inspirational...
Players, yeah, I didn't know other players were,
that's
like...
That's how inspirational he is.
Oh, dude, he, like, so, he communicates and with them.
We're going to have a lot of time to talk about this.
But how valuable is that, learning Spanish in a baseball dugout?
We're going to have a lot of... We're going to have months and months to talk about this, but I hate Lance Bregman's guts.
Bregman?
Or who's Lance
Alex
Bregman?
Bregman, pardon me.
Oh, okay, yeah.
I that has so Bregman. Much less impact. Lance Bergman, I confused Lance
you
Bergman.
You know what?
I
next
hate Alex Bregman.
Next week we are talking about
Alex
Lance Bergman
so much.
And his one season on the Hall of Fame ballot.
Yeah, sorry for
Alex this. Bregman really cares about
Lance Bregman.
Position.
Lance Bregman, nobody knows
Lance
who the fuck that guy is. No, I hate Alex Bregman.
Alex
so
Bregman
much.
Owns.
I hate him.
Laptop pitching. I understand why you hate him.
Laptop is closed.
No. We've run way over.
Alex Bregman, if you're listening.
Yeah. We're looking for a sponsor.
Alex Bregman, if you are listening, fuck this dude over here. He doesn't know what he's talking about.
Hey.
He doesn't have to burn everything at the plate.
When you got
a
cleaver.
Hey, Alex Bregman, if you're listening, I think you're going to know what I mean when I say you're a pendejo.
You know what? If you've ever watched Bregman and the Boys, his web series, you might just
so he tweeted out that Simone Biles is the best athlete in Houston or something like that. I gotta look at it. Don't quote me on this, but it seemed like he was reaching out to her on a personal.
Oh really?
He went out of his way.
I don't even know who she is.
Like, Simone Biles, get the fuck out of here. She's the gymnast that won all the gold medals.
Dude,
we have a daughter. Jesus Christ, this guy's not done. We should
don't make gymnastics.
No, you're more like a Derrick Rose. Just want to go last.
Wait. We're talking about...
On that note.
Yeah. You definitely want to
end it on that note. How does she spell her name? I do.
Simone? S-I-M-O-N-E?
I am a Derrick Rose.
Biles.
If you do Simone B, you will...
Simone B. If you just put in Simone. Simone Houston.
So you think Les Bregman is trying to get with...
I mean, look, I don't want to start rumors here, but that's how they get started. So, you know, fuck it. I will say it. Yeah. Maybe they're trying to get hooked up. I don't know. Maybe he's trying to...
Can you pull her up? Because I can't.
The problem with that is I think that she's young.
If he tried to make super babies with Simone Biles, that would be some craziness.
Yeah.
All right, we went way over. I got to apologize.
Way
to
over.
I don't know.
But I like us playing match maybe with Alex Bregman.
Okay, she's 21. We're safe. She's 4'8", though. That's the thing.
Oh, and he's only like 4'9", so
she's
4'8".
She is cute, man.
Yeah, no, she's a badass, dude. She is a badass.
Welcome to this generation.
Yeah,
in fact, pretty much the entire USA gymnastics.
Oh my gosh, she's like, does she not have one of the greatest smiles?
No, absolutely.
Oh my god,
absolutely.
They're the greatest kids ever, man. They're the greatest.
So and yeah, she's a Houstonian. So
and they're just gonna have a douchebag father.
Take that.
Wow.
God, it's not that cunt of a pitcher in Cleveland. What's his name? The one that keeps getting owned by Alex Bregman?
Oh, dude.
You better be careful. He's going to be an Astro before long. Then what are you going to say?
Oh, is that the...
Is
yeah, I know.
What are you going to say the day after Trevor Bauer becomes an Astro?
I'm
going
to say that he was
say?
Recruited to Houston by Alex Bregman.
Is he a closer?
He didn't want to face Bregman anymore. There was one player that owns him.
Is he a closer? Is he
There's
a closer?
One player... No, he's not a closer. He's a starter.
He's an excellent starter.
He's an excellent starter when he doesn't play Houston.
He would have won the Cy Young.
Specifically when he doesn't face Alex
Bregman. If he didn't have a bone broken in his leg on a comebacker, he's legitimately going to win the Cy Young.
All right, guys. We got to get the fuck out of here.
Fair enough. Guys, another great show. Thank you for being
fantastic.
Here.
Fantastic.
I don't know if you guys know this, but my mom listens to our podcast.
Hi, Mom.
And
Hi,
she
Mom.
Does not like the term shit cunt. So, Mom.
Sorry, Mom.
Well...
Sorry.
Mr. Dick and I will wash his mouth out with soap on air.
Is it air if we're not? Anyways, I don't know.
We're airing this broadcast, though, over the airwaves.
On that note.
On air.
On that note, I have a lawyer on retainer and I'm out of here.